And I'm joined by Hala Esfandiari, now director of the Middle East program at the Woodrow Wilson International Center for Scholars, and Karim Sajjadpour, an associate at the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace. And welcome to both of you.
Thank you.
Karim, starting with you, what's known about what led to the release today?
I think there's a few points worth mentioning. First is that there's no evidence against these three young hikers. The government detained them, Iranian government detained them, August of 2009, and they stopped interrogating them a couple months after their detention. So I think when you talk to people connected to their lawyers in Tehran, it's clear that the government didn't have any evidence against them. Second, she has a health concern. She found a lump on her breast, and I think the regime certainly didn't want to be put in a position where they would be responsible for her health. And I'm not convinced that President Ahmadinejad was responsible for her release, but I am convinced he will take credit for her release and try to spin it in a way to project himself as being a magnanimous, reasonable guy ahead of his visit to the UN General Assembly next week.
Now, well, this comes after a confusing series of pronouncements and counter-pronouncements over the last week. What do you see going on? First, the president said she would be released, and then the judiciary said, no, we'll do it.
Well, I think this was a way for the judiciary to score a point with the president, because the judiciary is a separate entity from the government, and the head of the judiciary is appointed by the supreme leader. So when Ahmadinejad, without consulting the judiciary, decided to make this announcement that, you know, they would let Sarah free, the judiciary immediately reacted and said it is for us to decide when she is going to be free. So it shows really the differences that is has been going on in the government all this time. They don't speak with one voice.
They don't. No. How independent is the judiciary in Iran?
We can't say it is independent, because a branch of the judiciary works very closely with the security apparatus and the intelligence ministry. But at least they would like to give the appearance that they can be independent if they want to.
So, but behind the scenes, it looks like a whole sort of, I don't know if it power struggle is too much or a lot of strife.
I think it's safe to say there is a power struggle in Iran. There was an interesting memoir written several years ago in the United States entitled How to Lose Friends and Alienate People. And I think Ahmadinejad in his post-presidential career could author that type of memoir on Iran, because it's remarkable how uncanny of an ability he has to get under people's skin in Iran.
And in the does, and the rest of the world
and
too,
the rest
but
of
you're
the
saying
world as well.
In Iran.
Well, that's the thing.
And what led to that?
Well, in the aftermath of the June 2009 presidential elections, any remaining moderates or pragmatists were essentially purged from the system. And what resulted was a very hardline government whose color spectrum ranges from pitch black to dark gray. And even among these conservatives, there's tremendous animosity towards Ahmadinejad. And the state of that the country is in right now, under tremendous external pressure, but also internal pressure.
Does that sound right to you in terms of the struggle?
I agree with Karim, but I think at the end, that's my guess, that the supreme leader had to intervene once again, like he did in my case, and probably told the judiciary, just let her go, put an end to it, because how much more do you want to discredit the president?
But the final decision will rest with the Grand Ayatollah.
Yes. I mean, if he says let her go, then let her go. And at least that was in my case.
Well, now, based on your case and going back now to the particular case of Sarah and her companions, any sense of whether they would have known what was going on behind the scenes, or might she have even expected to be released today? Would that have been a surprise? I know it's conjecture, but what do you think based on what you went through?
I hope she didn't. She was not told last week that she would be released, because then she, as we hear from her mother, she was suffering from depression, and that would have added to her depression. So I hope not, but I believe maybe when she met with her lawyer, they all three appeared in court yesterday. Mm-hmm. On Sunday, they appeared in court. So probably he told her this is what is going on. They want a bed, so she was expecting her release.
And in your case, you had thought you might be released at different times, or what is the?
I had been told on several occasions that I would be released in a week time, in 5 days time, and so on. They were very cruel, and I really didn't believe them. So the last time when I was summoned for interrogation, and I was, instead of being interrogated, I was told, pack your bag and go. I thought, this is really the ultimate of cruelty. Mm. But no, they were right.
Now, in the meantime, her two companions, Shane Bauer and Josh Fatale, are still being held. Might they face trial? Is there any hope for them or for release?
I doubt they will face trial, because then the regime will expose their own lack of evidence against them. But unfortunately, hostages in Iran oftentimes become political footballs. And, you know, I suppose President Ahmadinejad, he likes dramatic gestures, so I could even see him wanting to bring them on the plane with him when he comes to New York next week.
Really?
But as I mentioned, because of this internal political struggle, his conservative rivals will not want to give him that type of credit. So it's very unpredictable. I hope they're released very soon, but it's plausible that this could drag on for a little bit
longer. But you really think of them as pawns, all of these cases, yours too, as pawns Iranian politics?
I do. You know, it's unfortunate when you look at Iran's neighbors, particularly Turkey and Dubai. They've managed to build thriving economies by trading in goods and services. And even three decades after the revolution and the 1979 hostage crisis, this regime remains in the business of trading in human beings.
Do you think there's hope for a release?
I beg to differ. I usually agree with Karim, but on this point, I beg to differ. I think the regime needs a face-saving solution, and the face-saving solution is going to be to put the two on a trial and sentence them maybe to a year or 15 months, and they have served it, and ask for some bail and let them go, but not within the next 2-3 weeks. Things have to calm down a little bit after the release of Sarah. But I see for the first time a light at the end of the tunnel.
All right, we'll see what happens. Hala Esfandiari and Karim Sajidpour, thank you both very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.